morning, the Reverend Chairman Donald Harvey Perry, members of the panel, stakeholders, partners, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Once again, welcome to this, our public presentation of the environmental impact assessment for the Negril Breakwater project. Once again, I'm going to take this opportunity to apologize for our late start. Let me introduce myself again. My name is Janelle Ricketts and I'm the Community Relations Officer for the National Works Agency Western Region. At this point, I'm going to invite Ms. Liam Roper, member of the audience, to start us off with her.
Good afternoon, everyone. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you have brought us all here safely. And Father, as we are about to begin the proceedings, I pray that your presence will dwell among us. I pray, Lord, that even though we may have differing views, I pray, Lord, that we will respect each other's views. And I pray that the evening will be productive and a successful one. So Father, take control and take us to our respective places safely thereafter. Through your Son's name, I pray.
Amen. Thank you, Leanne. The proceedings this afternoon will be chaired by the Custos Reverend Canon Hartley, the Honorable Hartley Curran. You'll notice with us some persons at the head table. At this point, I will introduce you. We have Mr. Carlton Campbell from CEL Environmental. We also have Mr. Christopher Burgess, who is seated right beside you from CAC Solutions Limited. And we also have Ms. Jessica Stewart from CAC Solutions. At this time, I am going to introduce our moderator, Custos Rotolorum, the very honorable canon, the honorable Hardy Perry, Custos of Westmoreland. The Anglican Dean and past President of the Westmoreland Lay Magistrates Association has an outstanding track record for success in the parish of Westmoreland, spanning some 30 years. He's a true leader who believes in the power of discourse in mediating problems. Father Perrin, as he's known by many, has impacted countless lives throughout the parish of Westmoreland, especially in his community of Petersfield. He's a true son of Westmoreland whose life is marked by a legendary service to his fellow man. At this point, I'm going to turn you over to our moderator, Custos of Westmoreland. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Ricketts, for those kind words of introduction. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen on the platform, distinguished ladies and gentlemen in the audience, good afternoon. This afternoon, primarily for one purpose, to show again our love for our country. And we are here for the advancement and the welfare of all of us. Decisions that we will make this evening, discussions that we will have, will all be to the benefit of this place that we love so much, Jamaica. We may have different views and different opinions, and that is what makes life dynamic and interesting. And we are this evening to feel very free to express our opinions, our suggestions, our ideas, whatever they may be, on this most important subject that we are called upon to discuss this evening. And so I'm very excited to be here and look forward to seeing and hearing the presentations that will be made, as well as your responses to such presentations as they are made. The fact is that for those who have this program, you'll notice that there is an item 5, which allows for question and answer. I would ask you to look at that and put an S, because it will allow for questions and answers. So it's a question and answer segment, but we will have the plural. We'll have as many questions as we can facilitate and as many answers as there are. So we're going to relax. We're going to get ourselves very comfortable as we enjoy the company of each other, and we look holistically at the development of this area of Westmoreland Negril for today as well as for tomorrow. We have representatives from the National Work Agency, and I would like them to wave. National Work Agency. Representatives from National Work Agency, would you please wave, indicate? Yes. We have representatives from NEPA, National Environment and Planning Agency. Would you wave, please? NEPA? Yes, yes. And then we have participants from the Negril community. Would you wave? Let me see Negril. Yeah. Say yay! All right. So everybody's on board. Everybody's on board. We appreciate your coming and we look forward to your participation. We're going to have a presentation now from the NEPA. It's going to be a statement, and I invite the appropriate person, Jessica Stewart. Not just Ainsley Henry. Ainsley Henry. Mr. Ainsley Henry to come forward now and make a presentation. Mr. Henry, sir, please let him feel welcome.
Thank you very much. It's deputizing actually for Ainsley Henry. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and our stakeholders. This is a brief statement from NEPA, as is customary at public consultation. We need a brief statement to provide the information and process that we follow through the EIA environmental assessment process. On the 25th of January 2013, NEPA received a beach license application for the proposed construction and maintenance of two breakwaters, approximately 1.5 kilometers on the coast of Long Bay Negril by the National Works Agency. On reviewing the information presented in support of the application, conducting the environmental screening and site inspection, the agency determined that an environmental impact assessment was required for this project. Consequently, the applicant was advised, and a terms of reference for the EIA was prepared by the agency and submitted to the proponent. The EIA report was submitted to the agency on the 29th of April 2014. The report was widely circulated for review and comments. The circulation list included the Hanover and Westmoreland Parish Councils, the Negril Green Island Area Local Planning Authority, the Negril Coral Reef Preservation Society, the Negril Environmental Protection Trust, the University of the West Indies, the University of Technology, and the Jamaica Institute of Environmental Professionals. This public presentation is being undertaken by the applicant in accordance with the terms outlined in letter dated 25th of June 2014. The public consultation process is guided by specific terms and conditions, and a team from NEPA is present to ensure that these are met. You'll be pleased to know that the agency views this public consultation as integral to the review process. The issues raised by you, the stakeholders, will be treated as material consideration, and the agency will, where appropriate, require that the applicant provide clarification and or additional information. This process is important, and I'd like to just pause at this point to recognize that we have members of the Natural Resources Conservation Authority who are also here joining in this consultation. The agency is in attendance, and at this meeting, we're only here to observe the proceedings and to record the issues raised. Consequently, and subsequently to this, the statement, the team from the agency will not speak or answer questions, and this is the sole responsibility of the applicant and the consulting team at this forum. Please be reminded that there has been no decision on the application at this time. The process with respect to this public presentation is as follows. A copy of the verbatim minutes from this presentation to be submitted to the agency by the applicant within 7 days. The public is given the opportunity to provide written comments to the agency within 30 days of the date of this presentation today. The issues raised along with the responses provided by the applicant are incorporated in the respective submissions to the various committees and authority and will facilitate deliberations on the technical merits of the project. A recommendation will be made to the NRCA, which is the body with the sole responsibility for making the final decision. This public presentation and public consultation is extremely important in the further processing of the application and the decision-making process. The public consultation is to provide the public an opportunity or an additional opportunity to air concerns, comments, opinions, and views, and it also provide the applicant with an opportunity to address them. Your comments, as we said earlier, are important, and comments may be sent in writing to the agency at 10 Caledonia Avenue, Kingston 5, or via our email address applications@negril.gov.ga. Of course, we have indicated before that the documentation for the EIA are presently available on our website. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. McKenzie, for that presentation from NEPA. I think it has been comprehensive and seeks to outline exactly the role and function of NEPA in this whole developmental process. Thank you very much, Mr. McKenzie. If you have questions for him, hold them until such time when the questions time the segment comes. Now we'll have a presentation, design process, by Miss Jessica Stewart. Please make her feel appreciated.
Mr. Chairman.
I have a bit of a point of order.
Point of order, team.
Yes. Which is that the audience should really have some idea of the times that each of these presentations will take so that we can be sure that we will have enough time for the Q&A. My name is Diana McCauley. I'm a veteran of these meetings, and really we should start out with some idea that presentation one is going to be 15 minutes, 20 minutes, and so forth right through. So I'm asking you as chairman to really determine how much time each speaker will be given.
Okay, fair. I can take that on board, because we don't want to be here all night either. Everything has to be within context. Sometimes the presentations are so lengthy and the time for questions and answers are so short that, yes, it's a timely reminder. How long do you hope this presentation? I'm making an appeal here for, because I'm told that the presentation, the first one, is going to be about 20 minutes long. And the other one will be about that time frame, which means that you can take the numbers that they are and multiply by 20 minutes, and it gives you a fair idea how long before we get to where we want to go.
But we have four presentations.
I'm sorry?
We have four of them. That's one and two, and then we have two under item D.
Yes.
So all of them are going to be about 20 minutes each?
About 20 minutes, I'm advised. All right, let's see how 20 minutes are, because in where I'm from, 20 minutes could be 10 or 15. So let's see what happens with the 20 minutes. Let's see what happens. All right, let the first presentation come forward and let us see how the 20 minutes span out. All right, please make her welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Costas. Good afternoon, everyone. I will be going through the design process associated with the Breakwater project. So this is the outline that I will be following. I'll be reviewing some existing studies that we incorporated in our design process. I'll be going through the data that we collected, our assessment of climate change, and just some of the models that we ran to actually put this breakwater together. So this is a project summary. As we know, Jamaica is vulnerable to climate-related hazards. We experience frequent hurricanes, the effects of storm surge and sea level rise, and the PIOJ, in response to that, on behalf of the government of Jamaica, have implemented the Enhancing the Resilience of the Agricultural Sector and Coastal Areas to Protect Livelihoods and Improve Food Security Project, which is a part of the Adaptation Fund. And under this program, the construction of breakwater structures off Negril, offshore Negril, this sub-project was formulated. Now these are a number of the studies that we actually reviewed. Some are engineering design reports, coming up with solutions to address the erosion along the Negril coastline, and some are studies on climate change effects and things that are occurring. Some are done by NEPA, some are done by independent engineering consultants. And this is just to give you a feel of the work that we did in truly getting a grasp of the problem in Negril. Now, this is a summary of some of the main points that we received from our study. One is that shoreline erosion rate averaged between 1 meter per year between 1968 and 2007. And this was obtained primarily from the Smith-Warner report in 2007. We also learned from our research that central and northern sections of the beach are most vulnerable to shoreline erosion. And this was completed from a study by NEPA in 2012. And we also learned that the beach requires a minimum of 3 to 4 years to recover to its pre-storm position following a Category 4 event. So if we have a Category event affecting the coastline, it will take about 3 to 4 years for the beach to get back to what it was before the hurricane even occurred. The central, as I said before, the central and other sections were identified as most vulnerable to natural hazards. And the shallow reef that is currently exists in the central part of Long Bay has become damaged over time due to the passing of a lot of hurricanes. And so it doesn't offer as much protection as it used to particularly the central section of Long Bay. So several options for shoreline stabilization were considered. We looked at beach nourishment, we looked at providing nearshore breakwaters in the nearshore of the bay, we looked at beach nourishment and the breakwaters, we looked at extending the reef, so just having the breakwaters alone just surrounding the reef itself, and we looked at an integrated solution which was a combination of many of these options. And the integrated solution was the one that received the most support when we went to stakeholders initially in 2012. Now, this initial stakeholder consultation involved many persons or stakeholders within the Negril area, including Jamaica Hotel and Tourist Association, Jamaica Tourist Board. We had some hotels themselves, like Couples Resort, Breezes, Grand Resort, and Spa. And they supported the view that the central and northern section of Long Bay were to be focused on. They were the areas that were more susceptible to shoreline damage. They also approved of the integrated solution, which was a combination of breakwaters and beach nourishment. So this is the initial integrated solution that was presented during that initial stakeholder consultation. It was that we would have 9 breakwaters, some offshore, about 1.5 kilometers off the shoreline, and some near shore. And then we also have between 30 meters of beach nourishment for Long Bay and 20 meters of beach nourishment for Bloody Bay. And it was at a cost in 2007 of between $19.4 to $25.5 US million. So if we convert that to 2014 dollars, that would be about between $21 to $28 US million. We modified this integrated solution in 2013 because of budget constraints and to really just focus on the most critical areas of the shoreline. And we decided to implement 2 breakwater solutions. Reef extension option. And this will have the breakwaters being 400 meters long and the other 590 meters long, 1.3 kilometers offshore in 3 to 4 meter depths of water. And it would, at that time, this solution would protect 2,000 to 2,500 meters of the Long Bay shoreline. And it would cost $5.48 million, which now in 2014 dollars would be about $5.6 million. $100,000. So having done that and modified our approach, we started to collect data to finalize the design for the solution. So we had a bathymetric survey completed where we discovered that the shallow coastal depth, the shallow area of the shoreline in Long Bay, the depth is between 4 and 12 meters and extends up to about 2 kilometers offshore. We also learned that there's a 500 meter long pavement located 1.4 kilometers offshore, and that's the reef that everybody is very familiar with in the area. We collected some information on currents in the area and the sand, the type of sand that is actually present in Long Bay. And so we did use that moored ABCP and to collect current data over a 1 month period. So we had it offshore Negril. We moved it from one location to another. So it stayed in each location for 2 weeks and we collected current data there. We also used drogue tracking. Drogues are used to also measure currents in the area. And we collected sand samples at 6 locations. I'm not sure if it will be very clear to you, but there are 6 locations highlighted along the Long Bay shoreline. We also went and interviewed persons who are living and residing in the area. We interviewed 55 persons living and working here, and we used that information to calibrate the models because we didn't want the models to tell us something, and then when we talked to people, they said nothing like that ever happened following a certain event. We collected that information and we found out that hurricanes Gilbert and Ivan caused the most damage to the Long Bay shoreline, and that after hurricanes, residents and employees manually remove or reshape the sand that accretes or is eroding in the area. So that affects the time in which the beach will take to recover because you're speeding up the process yourself. We also did deep waterway climate analysis. So what we did was we took a point offshore Negril, about 4.5 kilometers offshore Negril. We checked our hurricane database, an international hurricane database, to find out which hurricanes come in the area and damage the shoreline. And then we found out that 9 Category 5 and 21 Category 4 events have affected this node or this area of Negril over the period from the 1850s, from the 1800s to 2013. We also found out that most severe hurricanes originate from the west. And we got the 100-year return period event. So we were able to identify what is the wave height and period that is affecting the shoreline, and that is what we're going to use in our actual model. So this image is just showing you some of the hurricanes that have affected the Negril coastline or in the area. Not all of them directly affect Negril, but just some that are in the area. This table is showing you the storm surge or how high does the water come up to on the shoreline, coming depending on the direction following different storm events. And then this image is showing you that after we've looked at all the hurricanes that have affected the area, we see that there's a trend of higher or stronger or more damaging hurricanes coming and affecting the shoreline over time. As you can see, more Category 4 and 5 hurricanes are occurring now than before. So we know that the shoreline is really susceptible to damage in the future. We looked at wave transformation modeling to identify, if we put the breakwaters in place, just what kind of protection can we notice. And we found that if you see the circle on the right, you will see that there is more protection to the northern and central sections of the coastline when we put the breakwaters in place. We also looked at long-term shoreline change. So we have data going back to 1968. We looked at aerial imagery and satellite imagery, and we want to know how has the shoreline moved over time? Because is it really true that the shoreline is changing? Is it really true that the shoreline is being eroded? And we found that there is that occurring, that the most critical sections are indeed the northern and central sections. If you look at in the area of Couples, Tuktoway, Rondell, and Sandals, we really see that they are getting the most erosion in our map when we looked at the aerial imagery. And we also noticed that about 63 to 73% of the erosion that's actually occurring is because of sea level rise. So it is not because, so we noticed that climate change is playing a great part in the damage that the shoreline is experiencing. We looked at cross-shore sediment transport to see, okay, when the waves are coming to the shoreline and attacking it in a perpendicular to the shoreline, what kind of damage is occurring, and can the breakwaters really stop that? We noticed, well, if I go back, you see that image, that erosion that's actually occurring. When we put the breakwaters in place, we modeled the breakwaters in place, we noticed that erosion that previously was there was diminished. So we know the results reveal that the breakwater will reduce and in some instances reverse shoreline erosion. We then looked at a long shore sediment transport model. We calibrated it with storm events that persons remembered. So we used the data that we actually collected on the ground from persons living and residing in the area. We had two options for the breakwater, and we noticed that when we used the option of having the southern breakwater being about 470 meters long and the northern being 570 meters long, we get more protection of the vulnerable areas of the coastline. So this is just, I'm showing you some of the model results that we got. So this is before any breakwaters are in place with 7 years of actual wave data in use. We found that there's erosion in the areas of erosion along the shoreline. When we put the breakwaters in place, you can see the two lines there. When you put the design breakwaters in place, you see that those same areas that had erosion, there's actually accretion or beach growth occurring in those areas. We then looked at the currents in the area because we want to know that when the breakwaters are there, they're not scraping stagnant water and they're not going to affect the marine life. And we found that when we put the breakwaters in place, there was just a minor decrease in the currents in the area, a drop of up to 22%. It varied between 4 and 22%. We looked at beach safety. Will the breakwaters cause rip currents and cause persons to it to be unsafe for persons to swim? Because Negril is a tourist area. We found that island-wide there's about 55 drownings per year. In Negril there's about 3 or so. And in Longbay in particular, you usually get about 1 drowning per year. And when we apply the beach safety criteria, an international standard, we found that when we put the breakwaters in place, under fast current conditions, the beach is actually safer because the currents actually decrease in those conditions. We did a flushing analysis. We wanted to see, all right, when water comes into the bay, does it come in and leave as it usually does? Because we want to make sure that marine life is not hampered by the breakwaters. We found that the flushing times in the bay increases between 4 and 13%. But the criteria is that it not be more than 7 days, and even with the increase, it doesn't increase past 7 days, at most 4 days, that it will take to flush the bay. We looked at sediment dispersion modeling. When we put the boulders in the water, and if there's any sediments on it, how will the currents move in the bay? And we found that the plume that will be generated by the boulders will not reach the shoreline, because remember the design has the breakwaters 1.5 kilometers offshore. So even with the natural current and changes in the currents because of the breakwaters, the plume will not reach the shoreline, so it will not affect anybody who is swimming in that area. We then visited a structural design of the breakwaters, and we had an initial this cross-section that we built a scale model for. So we went to the University of Delaware, we built this actual breakwater system to see how would it work and what kind of, and to make sure, fine-tune the design process so we didn't put something in there that wasn't going to be effective. When we did that, we realized that we needed to make some changes to the type of stone that we would be putting in the cross-section. And so the final selection has some core stone, heavy armor, and primary heavy armor between 0.5 and 10 tons, actually, in the cross-section for the breakwaters. So to summarize, this is a description of the project. There will be two breakwaters located between 1.5 km and 1.6 km offshore. Northern breakwater will be 516 meters long. The southern breakwater 422 meters long. They will be set so that the crest is at mean sea level. And so it is not possible for somebody who is actually on the shoreline to see the breakwaters in the water. You have to be at between 115 meters from the breakwaters to actually see the crest. And it is relative to popular dive and snorkel sites, it's about 1.0 kilometers away from those sites. So we don't see it affecting regular the livelihoods of persons in the bay. The project will last, has 3 phases, which will last a total of 30 months. The design process, which we completed, is about 7 months. We're finalizing it now with this consultation. Construction will be 11 months, and the monitoring process will be a year, so it will take another 12 months. We monitor wind protection for 2K to 2.5 kilometers of the shoreline, and the accretion will be in some areas up to 42 meters wide. We'll use 53,000 cubic meters of armed stone to complete the project, and this is just telling you the different sizes that we require. In terms of the construction methodology, we will have to prepare this, extend the site for construction. So we're going to create a stockpile site, and we're going to drive piles in the area and extend the land in the area of the South Negril River. We're going to dredge the South Negril River so that we can have space to stockpile, to put dredge the river, take out sand, put the sand in the area of the Negril, the South Negril River, and then so that we can extend the land that is actually there. We're going to place the stones. We're going to use, this is just showing you how the construction process would actually look like. You see the piles that are there, and we'll have the machinery to take up, take the sand and put it, place it in that area to extend the area. We're then going to place the boulders, and we're going to use turbidity barriers to remove the amount of sediments that, the sediments that come off of the boulder, we don't want it to reach to the shoreline. So we're going to trap sediments using a turbidity barrier. And we're going to place geotextile material on the seafloor to prevent, to make sure the structure is stable and to make sure the structure is stable. This is showing you, just simulating how the boulders will be placed in the area for the development of the breakwater. In terms of quality control measures, we're going to ensure that we recommend that the contractor conduct hydrographic survey, underwater photography, and weight sensor measurements to make sure we have the right stones going out there and we have minimal damage to the marine environment when we put the breakwaters in place. And we also have environmental specifications and NWA and NEPA to ensure that these are actually enforced and observed. So I have questions here, but we'll wait until the actual question and answer section for you to ask.
Thank you very much, Jessica. You will agree that she went below the 20 minutes mark if you were timing. So, yeah, she was below the 20 minutes mark. You never noticed that? Yeah, she was. I was timing her. She did exactly?
She did well.
Exactly 20 minutes, all right. Okay, wonderful. She's true to her word in that sense. The environmental impact assessment findings and measures will be presented now by Mr. Carlton Campbell, and I invite him to come forward. I'm speeding up this process, not talking, just allowing the thing to flow. So, Mr. Campbell, please come.
Members of the head table, specially invited guests, general public, good afternoon. We're doing the presentation on the EIA findings and need the 20 minutes embargo. So I might be going a little bit fast through just to see what can reach. Okay, as Jessica said, it falls on the general the adaptation program. We know Negril has been experiencing over 40-year erosion period, and the erosion is anywhere between 0.5 to 1 meter per year from shoreline. Of course, there are areas that have higher erosion, and as we're saying, anywhere between 20 to 50 meters in years. As you heard, the proposal is to have the two breakwaters offshore, 1.5 kilometers offshore. And it's no way of mitigating the erosion forces along the shoreline. So just to give you an idea, these are breakwaters, central reef, and you have some ideas of some of the properties along the area to have a bearing of where we're expected to be. That yellow line here, we'll talk about a little bit, but it's more for where we expect the barge that is carrying out the boulders to the breakwater areas to travel. I'm just giving you the satellite images so I can get a better view for it. Our stockpile area, as Jessica had mentioned, is downtown. This is the road to West End. This is the road behind Burger King. And the area that we're talking about is here, that we want to fill, to create the stockpile area. This is just a schematic to give you an idea. One of the dredging, as we said, is at the mouth of the river, that's what's the thought. and to create a small channel here to allow the fishers to get in and out, because presently at times they have difficulties getting in and out of the river because of silting. This material will be dredging here and some here to create the stop right there. These arrows are what we expect in terms of the truck traffic, in terms of delivering orders for the project. Coming down from the roundabout, right here we'll have flagmen come onto this site, deposit the boulders here, and then travel back all the way back up behind Burger King, up to here where it will enter the main road near the roundabout, and then the base went to do the necessary adjustments to deal with that traffic flow situation. Reduction in wave height, we expect with the breakwater there will be a reduction in wave height. We expect a 22% on average reduction in current. And the flushing time will increase, meaning that the time for the water to leave the bay will increase slightly. That we don't expect to be a problem because, as you see in the later slide, the time period. Currents, these are the areas that we have checked for the currents. Unfortunately, you can't see below to see the different reduction at the point. We looked at water quality, an important thing. We did 18 stations, three times, just to get an idea of what the water quality was around. Took water samples, also in water using probes, and collected samples to send back to the lab to test. Different parameters were checked. These are the stations, all spread out over the bay so that we could get a good coverage of what the water quality is like. Observations from water quality, temperature, salinity, specific conductivity, pH, and total lithium salt showed little variation, meaning from point to point, there's not much change between the stations that we're just showing. The South Negril River, which everybody knows, seems to be an area that is carrying nutrients, fresh water and nutrients, into the bay. And of course, the nutrient levels, as we generally know, is higher than the standard that NEPA has set, the national standard. And the areas that are the main culprits, South Negril River area, northern end of the bay, and somewhere in the middle. Just a point to note, even though we have these areas, and I know a lot of people are saying that the river and stuff, there are other upwellings and stuff that also carry nutrients into the bay that also contribute, and also runoff from properties and design. Fecal coliform, which is a measure of how, in terms of the likelihood of you having any problems from bacteria, so from sewage, they're all within the standard. We looked at phytoplankton, and an important thing is check and balance. The water quality we did was the physical looking at parameters, but the phytoplankton give you also another indicator. And what it did, basically, to confirm that the area that we're talking about in the bay is mildly nootrophic, meaning that nutrients are moderate. It's not extreme as some persons would think, and it's not pristine as others would also think. So there's some evidence that nutrients are in the bay. We look at the benthic community. That is what we call sea bottom. Bottom of the sea, you see what's here. Give you an idea of what the breakwater area looks like. It's located on pavement and dominated by algae, as you can see, a lot of algae. You have different coral sizes. And the area we generally know is affected from overfishing. And a point to note, apart from that, the reef has been damaged, as Jessica said, because of hurricanes. But also fishing practices. I understand over here sometimes people use the dynamite over here and stuff, so it has damaged the reef. There are different methods in which we use to do the survey. I won't bother to bore you since we have 20 minutes, but generally, we did three transits. Those are lines that we go across the area to look at. Three transects were done in the northern breakwater location, two in the southern, three along the foray between the two breakwaters, and one each in each of the major dive sites that we know, Shark and Shoaling. This map only gives an idea where the points that where we did these transects. Just for information, pavement, it's flat, low relief, made of carbonate rock, and little or no rigorosity. It's covered with a thin veneer of sand. Also, you have some algae and some hard coral and sessile organisms. Negril's pavement is typical. So most of the species are encrusting, as I said. We have an idea of roughly the estimates of the size classes. This gives you an idea of what one of the photo transit shots look like. This is the pavement, this is a quarter. And as you can see, most of that is covered by algae, or it appears that way. But when you look closer, then you'll sometimes find some very small corals located and encrusted in that area. What the research has shown, the area has less than 1% hard coral. We did a manual count just to get an idea, not just during the program. The foray, as I say, had low relief, with not much elevation. It's generally flat. Shark reef and throne room have more structure and coral diversity. Although it's on a dive site, it also has some algae there. Okay, not as much as in breakwater there. Of course, as I said, both sides are deeper than what we want to put the breakwater. Conditions for relocation, not ideal. Management of the area and fisheries will offer greater benefits in our opinion to the benthic community. These are some pictures to give you an idea of the shark reef and throne room. The reef crest is slightly more diverse than the breakwater area. We have the endangered palmata, or Procora palmata here. It's bordered by dense seagrass beds, and it has slightly more structure than the breakwater area, hence more diversity. It too is also dominated by algae. Reef crest for reef, those are some pictures. Look at the lagoon. Typical of the shallow crest reef that's along the north coast, not only in Europe. Dominated, as I said, by algae and turf. It's a patch reef, and there are some bladder colonies outside of it. In the lagoon, you have healthy seagrass beds, dominated by two main species, Thalassia and Cirrhidium, turkey grass and some pictures to give you an idea of what it looks like in terms of the seagrass beds. Looking at the comparison of the reef structure community, this is the north breakwater, south breakwater. Things that stands out immediately is the amount of algae in the area. You can see both north and south have higher algal cover than the foray and dark sides. We also look at the groin, which is down the south of the area, but look at the north groin. Composed mainly of algae too. There are some algae, there are some sponges, some hard corals attached to the groin. There are also invertebrates, urchins, and lobster. And there you find relatively large schools of fish, mostly goat and juvenile mahogany snapper. Also, there are also numerous amount of lionfish. The ground can act as a fish aggregating device, of course. But right, as you can see there, you have a lot of fish in that area. Not seen when you're snorkeling or on a glass bottom boat. relatively little structure in the reef in the grill, so there's not much structure for the horizon to go. And we anticipate that with the breakwaters, it will also act as also a fish migrating device, as we're showing you. If managed, this site can also be used in the future as an alternative dive site, because we expect organisms to come in and occupy it. We also looked at fish using we did surveys along the transect lines. Numbers and sizes were recorded. General presence of fish pots, nets, spear fishing, and also the invasive rare species. In the breakwater, there are 10 species of fish observed. Dominant fish in the north was the French duck, of this size, 11 to 20 centimeters. In the south was the barger, that was the dominant. Also small fishes, 6 to 10. And fish densities were generally low in those areas, except for French grunt and barger. Herbivorous fishes is important in terms of for removal of algae from the reef and structures. North breakwater, they only found 5 species. South, they only found 4. And you notice the parrotfish was the most abundant, but the size, 0 to 5 centimeter, which means a lot of the adults are being taken away. In the fore reef, same general thing, small parrotfish. We have a problem when it comes to parrotfish, or preserving parrotfish. On the fore reef, there are some landfish that were observed, low numbers though. Moderate species diversity, 17 species were found in the fore reef, which was much more than what was found in the breakwater area. At the dive sites, they show the highest diversity in parrotfish, damsel, and chromis. They are small, but a little bit bigger than what was found in the reef area, 11 to 20. And of course, they had more herbivorous fish at the dive site, so that would help in containing the algal growth in those areas. We also did a social survey. We looked at a 4 kilometer, what we call SIA, around the breakwater area, and we did surveys in there. The SIA covered two parishes, Hanover and Westmoreland. And it encompasses sections of Orange Bay, Negril, Sheffield, Whitehall, and Westland, which we know as West End. From the starting data, we know that in 2001 you had about 3,700 persons in that area. And in 2011 it increased to about 4,500. Based on that growth rate, we expect that in the time we did the study, there was about 4,700 persons there. And we expect over the next 25 years that population to grow somewhere between 7,900 persons. We looked at tourism. Negril accounts for 20.9% of the stopovers in 2012. A lot of hotels here, so preaching to the converted. It's the third most visited resort here in the island. It has about 5,300 rooms, which represents about a quarter of the hotel rooms on the island. The occupancy rate was about 61.3% in 2012, which showed a marginal increase from 2011. And from the tourism market, they generate about 9,300 direct jobs. Which accounts for 27% of employment in this sector. And from those direct jobs, we expect induced and indirect jobs of about 19,000. The social survey, we use two techniques. We use questionnaires, and that gives you an idea. We use 355 questionnaires to give you an idea of the breakdown. And we also look at focus groups. We did 4 focus groups. Present some of the results from the survey. For the community, approximately 62% out of 66% of the persons stated that they have noticed, had not noticed any environmental change in our community. Others observed other changes, temperature, burning, beach erosion, littering, and the list goes on. When we did specific to Long Bay, the problems that they encountered was odor, garbage, flooding, beach erosion, burning of the seaweed and beach, and as you can see, blockage of the river by sand. If we look, 89.7% of the 90% of the persons we interviewed weren't aware of the plastic or shock, the breakwaters. 82% didn't have any concern regarding the project when we outlaid to them what was the project. And those that had concern had a variety of concerns, from impact on recreational activities, the water sports persons, and the duration of the construction phase. 94% or 95% of the residents that were interviewed believe that breakwaters are needed in the Long Bay area. When asked about the construction possibly causing negative impact on business, the majority stated that they believe it would have been no effect. 72% expressed construction activity will alter their or affect, will not affect their income. We looked at the water sports operator. 70% indicated that they have noticed changes in water or their environment in which they work. Responses that were given, the most significant was beach erosion, was the one that was most stated. 55% observed the change and effects on their business. So because of the changes, they had an impact on their business. But most of them, 9%, never lost any customers due to the problem. Six to eight of these water sports persons stated that they're not lost their customers, and 68 believe that the breakwaters would alleviate some of the problems that's been experienced in the erosion in the bay. 47% had other opinions on how the bay could be protected, fixing the sewage problem, building an artificial reef, implementing more restrictions that you have the list there. Look at fishers, 88% were aware of environmental problems. When asked in the changes they observed in the last 10 years, including river pollution from the sewage, from the treatment plant, blockage of the river from sand, beach erosion, the unhealthy appearance of the reef, and reduction in fish numbers. We also surveyed tourists, just to have a feel for what they think. 8% of whom we had interviewed visited Long Bay previously. Your five main activities, sunbathing, restaurants, jogging and walking, swimming, and glass bottom boat tours. 89% says the environment plays an important role in where they choose to do their destination, their tourism destination. When asked to rate the environmental quality of Long Bay Beach, 54 rated it good, 54%, 28 excellent, and 1.9 rated it as poor. Problems they describe: beach erosion, garbage pollution, noise, nuisance from jet skis, visually unpleasant beach vegetation, and presence of oil in water, and plus the reef deterioration. 75% were of the opinion that the construction and breakwater will assist in protecting the beach from erosion. They also were about 23% said there were other means that could have been used. 56% said they would be willing to pay an additional amount to use Long Bay Beach if there are conservation efforts there. Retail and other services, 71% noticed change in the water and environment. Most significant, beach erosion, hotel development, smaller fish population. We also did retail and other persons along the Long Bay Beach, just to get a feedback from them. Most of them believe that water were needed, but the breakwaters were needed in the Long Bay Beach area. 85% the construction that caused them to relocate, 70% believe that the breakwater would not affect their core business, but there was a 50%
that figured that it could impact their livelihood.
The focus groups, four focus groups, we had a total of about 52 persons. These are the stakeholders, the environment, officials, the water sport, the planning people, and the hoteliers.
We're put in four separate focus groups.
In addition, there was another meeting
that we had preliminary with the Negril Resort Board, just to brief them on what we were thinking about.
Technical issues raised in the focus group. Participants suggested the monitoring period proposed was insufficient. Review of the technical specifications for appropriateness of the location and the design of the breakwater. Disagreement with the major points of the erosion identified in project. Negative effects of dredging the river. Effects of the structure and the natural flow of the ocean and sea life. The aesthetics of the breakwater during construction and post-construction. In terms of logistics issues, concern about the ability of the trucks to maneuver within the designated stop line area. They identified that we need indicators on the breakwater areas to alert of the physical structure so that people don't run aground. The appropriateness of the season for construction, dignity of the tourism season, and emergency response procedures in terms of fire. And the justification of the route taken and the stockpile area that was proposed. We look also to talk about air and noise pollution, traffic congestion in the stockpile area, safety concerns in particular the trucks transporting these boulders in the Negril area, and the impact of breakwaters on the livelihood of snorkelers, fishing, diving, and water sports sources. It's probably been thought as clear. But these are some of the dive sites I snorkeled here that you can't see them away from me. Summer conclusion of the main issues. Great efforts made for the relevant authorities to sensitize the public of Negril about the project. Level of high awareness of erosion problems facing the area. General concerns regarding logistics and technical specification. The alternatives that were suggested, and the project is likely to yield benefits in terms of mitigating erosion problems. There's a picture showing you the beach, some of the activities. We looked at 10 alternatives, 9 alternatives, no action as is, leaving the project this area as is. The project has proposed different configuration of breakwaters, different staging areas, with improved aesthetics. Reball breakwater design, proposed project with South River desilting options either on the mouth of the river or a section of the mouth of the river, relocation and beach nourishment. And then we came up with that. I won't go on to it. We looked at impact and mitigations. We have some, I mean, can look at it, but one of the things that I think are standard, look at where the stockpile would be and how we stockpile the material. Look at how we deal with marine boating issues, employment, aesthetics. We are repairing that you won't be able to see it in terms of the looks when it's there. Looking at what impacts potential. And one of the important things I think going forward is this, community engagement. It's recommended that we have a stakeholder engagement committee that would meet with various stakeholders that we propose that we think would solve some of the issues so that there's an interface where the project managers, the contractor, and the community can meet on a regular basis to discuss any issues that they're having with the construction of the just a glow of that picture over here where we expect some of the major features to happen. And I think that's about it. Thank you.
may have gone on a little longer than the 20 minutes, but he certainly was not boring. He was boring, was he?
Yes!
If you think he was boring, you should come to church Sunday morning. Anyway, thank you very much, Mr. Campbell, for informing and educating us in this way. We're not going to have thing. Yes, Ms. McCall.
Me again. Unfortunately,
the main function of Mr. Campbell is, and this meeting here today, is to talk about environmental impacts. And that is the piece he just zipped through at the end there. The need for us to have enough time to talk about these things. I think if we want to really hear about how they're proposing to mitigate what they're planning to do, Mr. Campbell, you really have to spend a little bit more time on really why you're standing up there, less time telling people about the tourism industry and all that kind of stuff. Okay, so I think I certainly want to know a bit more about how this, all these truckloads of stones and all of these silt screens, which I personally have photographed, washed up on every beach that have been used in Jamaica, serving no function whatsoever, is going to work.
Yes.
Okay, in fairness, yes. In fairness, item D, yes. Responds to issues raised in the media. Number one says environmental, and number two, engineering. And the same Mr. Carlton Campbell is a person who is going to speak about the environmental impact. So, in fairness to him, there is a little slot there for him to address that. All right? So, we want to thank him. We don't want to hurt him too much. We want to thank him for his presentation. Now we're going to call upon him again. He's going to be the one to tell us about the response to the issues raised in the media relative to the environmental and other such matters. Mr. Campbell? All right, since this is what we want to hear, give him a round of applause.
I'd have loved to go to the impacts, so, but because of the time constraint. But can I go back to the impact section? Do you mind?
Yes, go back.
Magic. Broke up the impact section into site preparation, construction, and during the operation phase of the project. Try to highlight what we think were the major issues that would have been a problem. So we're talking about material storage and equipment operation on this stockpile. That's the first thing here. So we're saying to prevent runoff from that stockpile here to the marine or the riverine area. There's a, what is proposed is what we call an oil water separator, which the drain would be designed to drain towards that water collecting a sump, and then from there, if any water is collected, the oil water separator will clean that off. That will be taken out, and the water that's left would be without the impurities that could be released. That's the first thing. In terms of air quality, a couple of things, I mean, that we have to look at. One is in terms of from the quarry section, even though we didn't touch on much of it because of what was happening. You have to, in terms of general good practice, wet frequently. Depending on the temperature, then you might have to wet even more frequently. In terms of at the site, at the construction, at the stockpile here, then of course, if there's an issue with dust, then we have to wet there too. From time to time, a lot of the trucks that we have that operate on our roads tend to track the dust. What is proposed is that from at the quarry end, then before they leave the quarry, then the wheels would be washed off and go through the roof. Now
Hypo Notion, we did in there, we did some models to give an idea of what we expect from the piling operations that was 2 weeks piling. We looked at what we also looked at the operation of the front end loader to load boulders onto the barge. And we also looked at the noise from the barge going up to the breakwater areas. In there, based on the what we found, the operation of the barge is not an issue in terms of looking, I mean it's in the other slide, but in terms of looking at the piling, we expect there some short-term impacts on community nearby, and the buildings nearby are community. And in terms of the operation of moving the boulders to the barge, then we don't expect the noise to be exceeding 55 decibels, much further than probably closer to the river. In terms of water quality, the same thing, we have to look at the drainage. In terms of the boulders, what is proposed is that the boulders are washed from the quarries. So we don't expect, and it's the instruction is that once it reaches here, if there's any sediments on those boulders, then they are to be rejected. So all of the dust that we expect to come from the boulders is eliminated from source. In terms of water quality, about the silt screens are generally effective within 3 to 4 meters of water. Over that, then you tend to have problems. The area around there is 3 to 4 meters, and once they have a dedicated silt screen team, it's anchored properly, but you have persons that monitor to ensure that any movement then it is fixed quickly. You don't expect that during storm occasions or storm events, the silt screens should be out there, because then they'll get dislodged, and of course we have the reefing proximity, which Diana talks about. So in terms of that, we have to have a dedicated, the contractor have to have a dedicated silt screen team to deal with. Looking at the silt screen, ensuring every morning and through the day as it's fastened and anchored properly. And in case of storm events, they have to remove. Same thing with the operation, we don't expect the operations of the laying of the boulders to be occurred during storm occasion. Monitoring of the water quality, as I said, should be conducted fortnightly. One of the reasons why we suggest fortnightly is because we want to also look at the phytoplankton community. Phytoplankton community is plants which are important for fish. A lot of fish eat the phytoplankton as food. So we don't want whatever activity that we are doing impacts that food chain. In terms of the Salt Negril River, at the meeting we had, their concerns were raised about the drying out of the morass. Consequently, we spoke with the engineer proponent to look at what's the best way to handle something like this. There are three options that are on the table. One was that we would have reduced the area that we wanted to dredge in the up the mouth of the river to a channel so as to allow the fishers to go in and out. But we also said that based on that though, we did a hydrological study just to ensure that it doesn't change the hydrodynamic of the river. There's also another option. I mean, this is where I know they come to, but getting material from somewhere else. I mean, there's another option. So those are the options. We know in terms of waste generation and disposal, we don't expect people to bathe themselves. We know they use bathrooms, they use porta potties. Road safety, there has to be a traffic management plan that has to be produced. It will include flatmen, operating the trucks off peak, and stockpiling here so that we don't have such a whole heap of trucks coming in at any one time. This is just a schematic to give you an idea of stockpiling on the area.
We're seeing different stockpiles here. This is the front end load of loading the boulders that are here onto the barge. And this is the navigation route out, as I had showed earlier, going towards the breakwater. As you can see, the South Negril River is in the North River, and that's the South Dry. In terms of the maritime operation during construction, clearly defined path has to be put out for the barge, and we say that marker buoys need to be there so that the barge operators know the lane that they need to operate and away from any reef or any other sensitive areas in the bay. That area I've already defined is just for buoys and stuff to be put in once the project and if the project goes ahead. As I said before, the contractor has to give a maritime traffic management and safety plan. And a part of the thing that I've highlighted before about that community, that enhanced engagement committee, is that both the management plan, the times of operation, all of that in my mind needs to be discussed and agreed on within that community so that everybody is on the same wavelength. You might, as a community, have see other potential issues that can arise, and this is where you can trash it out so that the solutions can be arrived at and persons don't feel that they're left out and their ideas or opinions are not valid or are valued. In terms of the pavement, as we're saying, it's low. Fish diversity is also low. We also, in terms of the operation of the barge, because there's a reef in the air, we have to ensure that the barge is properly operated. No defective barge being used so that it will run aground or get out of control. We also, as I said before, the material, the boulders will be washed before being carried out. So we don't expect any sediments from the boulders to get into the water. In terms of the fish community, there needs to be a sensitization, education effort, especially the construction personnel when dealing with things like turtles and other invertebrates, how to deal with them if we come across them. We have said that a spotter should be used, especially when you're coming in with a barge and to put on boulders, just to ensure that we're not crushing any of those sensitive maritime. As I said, maritime users, the water sports persons, snorkelers, and swimmers need to have an idea of the route and also the times so that people can adequately plan and don't run into problems that we end up in the same lane. Environment, no mitigation, aesthetics. One of the things that was recommended, I pointed out that we could put construction screen around the staging area so as to block out some of the visual intrusion from persons on the road and around the area. I don't think that's interesting, but yeah. In terms of the barges, you have to have properly functioning barges. You don't want barges traveling with oil tailing behind or things falling off or rust looking. And also, importantly, appropriate signage, both construction and on the barge and also in the stockpile here. And as part of the education thing, the hoteliers need to have information so that they can inform their guests about what is happening. In terms of local maritime businesses, we need a fishing liaison officer, I think, someone who knows about the whole fishing culture here, to ensure that whatever is proposed is not obstructing or creating a problem for the fishers. The others are, as I spoke about, and also ensure that the safety and management plans are in place, for especially emergency plans.
You know, what happened if there's a fire on board, how we handle it, if there's an accident, you know, where they go, how they get medical assistance. All of that would have to be done as a part of the contractor. And I think we present it to the NK debate committee would have us to see what is proposed.
Spoke about that already. That is what I think is the best way. I've seen it. We have used it, this method already in a project in an area that has been difficult, that is considered difficult to do construction. We have done it in West Kingston and I think it worked well. We never had any stoppages, we never had any fires, we never had any killings on site. And that project was easily 100 times more expensive than this. During operations, the erosion, we expect some accretion to occur. As I was saying, you can have a look over there on the map to see where we expect most of it from central up, and then there's a section here where you have some accretion going down to the south of the river. So we don't anticipate based on that and based on what we expect in terms of a reduction in the wave energy reaching the shore, that there's a mitigation in terms of erosion. In terms of the persons have asked about seagrass beds, person who asked about organism, marine organism, in terms of it changing in the flushing time and the currents. Because the changes are relatively small, we don't anticipate that there is much change that will happen to negatively impact these organisms. How long to the flushing time? 7 days is what is considered the critical mass, where you want it, where you get considered being nervous or your major point. We are now in all the areas during all wind conditions, we expect to need that 7 days. So in terms of eutrophication and build up lesion, we don't expect that to happen. They spoke about the safety of swimmers. As we said, because of the calmer waters, we expect that swimming safety will improve. And as I said, this is where we expect the accretion. Drill operation. We expect the breakwaters, because of the structures, are boulders, there are spaces in between. As we had shown with the break, with the groin at South Negril River, there are spaces in between which fish and other invertebrates and lobsters and so can occupy as a safe haven. Presently out there, because the area is flat, there's not much what we call housing for these organisms. So that would improve the area in terms of that. In terms of the request that I know before, in terms of the breakwaters blocking organisms and mammals from coming ashore, the breakwaters are situated 20 to 40 meters from the end of that reef crest. So there's a gap there that they can use. Bear in mind that in time past, there was a reef there. So we don't expect that. I mean, yes, it will cost, but together the animals are smart enough to go through that gap to get to the shoreline. As I said before, we don't expect any significant changes to the crustaceans, the seagrass in terms of the currents and the waves. Maritime operations, two things have to happen. They have to be a marker there so that persons know that it is there and over the ground, and also they are part of the charts. That is where Maritime Authority has to put those in the charts. So that persons coming in will know that there's an obstruction here. So it's a twofold thing that has to be done. In terms of aesthetics, we looked at doing the calculation. We said in the EIA that once it's out there, we wouldn't be able to see the breakwaters from shore.
I know some persons are doubtful, but we went a step further and we used a fishing boat of approximately the same height of where if any boulder that would come out of the height of those boulders. That I took out of this presentation because it was long, but somewhere else. But you get a feel for what it looks like from shore. Really can't see. You expect the most a boulder, it's not the whole stretch. A boulder or two might be about 0.4 meters above mean sea level. It's not the whole stretch. So you really can't see it. And I'm confident of that. Unless you're right up on it. This guys have spoken for now away from the main dive sites, so we don't expect them to have any impact on the dives. Because of the structure, we expect fishes to congregate there. One of the things that we have proposed in it is that you may have to manage that here, because once they have that happening, then you find the fishes are going to go there, and it's easy catch, you know. To make it effective, then you're going to have some amount of management and prevention of fishing, either limited or none at all in that area. Gives them a chance for the fish stock to record in the grill, but that's something that a management plan has to deal with. And I think I covered most of the concerns. Thank you for listening, and I hope I saw the most of your concerns. All right.
All right. All right.
Thank you very much, Mr. Campbell. He has done well.
Yes.
It's very few yes. occasions that one batsman get to bat twice. We are now going to be having the engineering report, and this is going to be done by Mr. Christopher Burgess. He will say something about the engineering part of it. If we've heard about the environmental impact, we're now going to be hearing about the engineering. So I now invite Mr. Christopher Burgess. Please make him welcome.
Thank you, Costas. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Slight correction, I'm going to add to the engineering presentation which Jessica had done earlier by addressing some of the issues which were raised in the media over the last 3-4 months as it relates to the engineering of the project. And the format of this presentation is answering a number of questions which have appeared in one form or the other. The first question that I'm attempting to answer is why Negril? Why Negril for this project? How does Negril Beach compare to other beaches in Jamaica? The fact is that Negril is the fastest eroding beach in Jamaica when compared to approximately 8 or 9 other beaches. In terms of rate, it averages between 0.6 and 0.8 in most of its length. And the next fastest beach is Old Harbor Bay in Clarendon, St. Patrick. And so there's need there as well. Followed by Fort Clarence and Hillshaw at 0.42 meters per year. So Negril is at the top of the list in terms of erosion rates, but very close behind is Old Harbor Bay and then Fort Clarence. And that essentially is shown in this graph, which represents the various beaches across the island. The only accreting beach observed out of this set of 10 is Little Boche, and that's a bit of an anomaly, but the rest of the beaches are eroding. Alright, the question is
some of us have a very big voice and a big mouth, but some don't. Would you move the person who's monitoring the microphone, just give him a little more volume, since his mouth is not as big as mine tend to be. Thank you.
I don't practice on Sundays. And to be honest with you, my two children don't require a lot of talk. All right, so the next question that I'm putting, that I'm trying to address in the presentation is, why do breakwaters fail? And reality is that there are some breakwaters that fail. There are some submerged breakwaters that have failed. And they tend to be breakwaters which were implemented in the 60s, 70s, 80s. And the reason why they failed has only recently come to light, to refer to the scientists and engineers involved, recently being the last 10, 15 years. And the reason why they have failed is because in most instances they were placed too close to the shoreline and they interrupted the sediment transport rate. And they also modified the currents and the waves in such a way that they resulted in erosion at the ends of the breakwaters. And this is clear to the coastal engineer and the scientist. Hello? Yvonne. Just to illustrate that point with a graph, we see a submerged breakwater here, the shoreline, which is the beach in the north, and the currents which come out on either side of the breakwater, eroding the shoreline with those two orange areas. This is similar to what would happen if the nearshore breakwaters in the integrated plan were to have been implemented. And so, for that reason, we cannot see the integrated plan as a finished plan. We have to see it as a work in progress. Why won't this happen in Negril? This won't happen in Negril with the two breakwaters that are being proposed because we are far offshore. And not only are we far offshore, but whereas the breakwaters that failed in the past had a two-cell scenario, our breakwater will have, at the very least, a four-cell scenario. The currents that it will be set up to a pre-sun, whereas those for the nearshore breakwaters that were previously proposed would have resulted in erosion on either ends. And so, for the Negril's breakwater, we have a four-cell situation for our currents, and we're also well offshore. So we're not in that category of breakwaters which will lead to erosion. Why two breakwaters? Well, it's not just two breakwaters in total that will be necessary for Negril to function, or rather to resolve the erosion problem. The reality, as Jessica had suggested, that the integrated plan had suggested 9 breakwaters, 5 offshore and 4 nearshore. Total of 9, plus beach nourishment of 500,000 cubic meters, 30 meters for Long Bay and 20 meters for Bloody Bay. We are only doing or focusing on 2 of these 5 offshore breakwaters for this project, because that is the focus of this project. So why these 2 breakwaters? These 2 breakwaters are preferred because the focus of erosion is the northern and central part of Long Bay. Also, in terms of phasing, these 2 breakwaters will give us more accretion for the investment involved than any other 2 of the breakwaters in the plan that was suggested before, the integrated plan suggested before by Smith Wall. Also, the funds available don't allow us to do more than 2 breakwaters. Some have said we need more breakwaters, and some have said we need no breakwaters and beach nourishment. So I'm just explaining why it is 2 breakwaters and not exactly as has been prescribed in the integrated plan. Why not the beach nourishment first? Why not the beach nourishment first? Because evidence has shown us that sand is eroding gradually. Shoreline is eroding. Our sediment transport simulations have showed us that if you put the nourishment there, it will be unstable and will move to the south. Also, our understanding of climate change is that sea level
is active and has been responsible for 63% to 73% of erosion that we have experienced. So putting sand there will not mitigate against effects of sea level rise. It will delay it, but not mitigate it. Also, why not beach nourishment first and why breakwaters first? Because the preliminary engineering report, which many refer to, suggested that in the phasing of the integrated solution, that breakwaters is to lead the beach nourishment. So this is consistent with the preliminary engineering report. And why not beach nourishment first? Because if you look at investing in beach nourishment first and look at the cost at the end of the 40-year period, the cost for beach nourishment is approximately 28 million versus the cost for breakwaters combined with beach nourishment, which is 22 million. So, and lastly, why not beach nourishment first? Because the reality is that beach nourishment does have environmental impacts associated with it. In this diagram, you'll see approximately five red pipelines leading to the shoreline, which are our approximation of the pipelines that were required to pump the sand on shore. These pipelines would cross a number of the seagrass beds, which mean a lot to the people of Negril. It's often mentioned that these pipelines can be floated, but it cannot be floated without being anchored, and it can only be anchored in the seagrass beds, the same seagrass beds that we're hoping to build. So the reality is that pumping the sand on shore does have environmental issues, which entail crossing the seagrass bed and pumping the sand onto the shoreline. This is an example of a beach nourishment program. You can see the tractor on the shoreline on the beach. Here's another one pushing the sand that has been pumped on shore around and shaping it. Here's another one with a pipeline on the shoreline with the sand being pumped on. And this is one of the realities that we have to be coped with as well if we're going to go with beach nourishment. Another aspect of beach nourishment is that it does generate a sediment plume unless it is controlled, and that too can affect the seagrass bed. So that too has environmental issues. Another question that has been raised as it relates to our engineering approach is, why are we doing engineering designs without first doing a coastal zone management plan? The reality is that we have a challenge now, erosion. And reality is that we have a solution now, the adaptation funds, which the PIOJ have managed to secure. Never, as far as we're aware, are working on some plan, on a plan for Negril. Also, what we have done in terms of our approach in the engineering and the environmental impact assessment does not jeopardize an integrated coastal zone management plan. What is an integrated coastal zone management plan? So an integrated coastal zone management plan, or rather management, is the process of management of a coastal area using an integrated approach. It essentially is coming out of Rio de Janeiro in 1992, a concept which calls for nations to be responsible in how they integrate planning with communities and natural resources. What are the main aspects? There's a spatial aspect for an integrated coastal zone management plan. There's functional aspects of considering fisheries, circulation, livelihood, the legal aspects. There's aspects of gathering knowledge from local knowledge to expert knowledge. And there's also the aspect of participation. All of these key ingredients of an integrated coastal zone plan have been incorporated in this process from the initial consultations carried out by PIOJ in 2012. To today, and it will continue until the project is complete. The long and short of it is that what we are doing is similar to and consistent with carrying out an integrated plan. It does not jeopardize a holistic plan for the area, and when that plan is being crafted,
by relevant institution, they will find that what they have done would not have jeopardized them carrying out that plan. The next question is, are slums increasing? And Jessica alluded it in her presentation. Reality is that yes, category 4 and 5 storms are increasing, but overall there is less hurricanes anticipated in the future. But hurricanes that will happen will have more category 4 and 5. In other words, what we'll get in the future are more adverse storms. And this is consistent with what we have observed locally, and it's consistent with what other researchers have observed looking at their own data sets. And the infamous question, will the stones move? Will they end up in water? The reality is that every engineering structure, including buildings, are expected to move and to shift. And to the extent that they move and remain functional afterwards, that is the success of structure. We expect one out of approximately 200 to 930 stones to move in a 100-year event, and not move towards land, but rather to move seaward. How do we know this? We know this from a number of physical wave studies that we have undertaken. Matthew. So I have a short video to show, which is this structure in the wave room. I'm sorry that the sound is not there. But here is the same structure that we're proposing being exposed to the 100-year waves. And we ran it for the 100-year waves with climate change. As in the more intense waves expected in the future, and also with higher sea levels. And after the study was complete and the waters had settled down, we looked at where the stones had moved. And when this process was repeated for the duration of several hurricanes, and the scale model was scanned, and these are the stones, and this is the sand in the flume, we're able to, this is the landward side, and this is the seaward side. What we observed was that there was approximately 3 stones in this entire length of the breakwater that had moved seaward. There's a physical reason for it, and actually it is based on the bathymetry of Negril that goes out to that outer reef. That outer reef actually does a lot of filtering of the waves, and so no matter what is happening in deep sea, that crest helps to moderate what is happening beyond it. And even more important, to preserve the reefs that are offshore. And so the long and short of it is, yes, a few stones will move, they're well within the tolerance of traditional engineering, and they'll be more seaward.
We can't move so far. We can't move so far.
How does the cost of the beach nourishment compare with the cost of the breakwater? Well, the reality is that the estimates for the beach nourishment, which have been circulated, have not had the benefit of the hydrographic survey which we have done. As a matter of fact, the hydrographic survey, which we did as a part of the study, actually detected an error in the previous surveys that were used for the preliminary engineering report of 0.5 meters. Now, while 0.5 meters may not sound like a lot to some, it translates to about $500,000 in materials, US dollars in materials, when the contractor would have gone there and found the water that's deeper than they actually were shown on those charts. So with this accurate information, which goes from the shoreline out to our breakwaters, we're able to develop an accurate estimate of the quantities of the two options.
And the long and short of it is, when you take maintenance into consideration, is that a reasonably representative beach nourishment program, which would consist of 35 meters of beach nourishment in Long Bay, not 30 meters, but 30 meters would be inadequate, would cost about $31 million. And when all necessary breakwaters and some beach nourishment are implemented for the grill, that would cost about $21 million. So that's a cost difference savings of about $10 million for the beach nourishment and breakwater option versus the nourishment option alone. So long term, medium term, the costs favor an approach which implements the breakwaters first, then beach nourishment. Is the estimate for this phase enough? The professionals involved in creating or generating an estimate for this project have been involved in coastal engineering projects, the largest coastal engineering projects for Jamaica that have occurred recently and that have been executed successfully. You're talking about teams of quantity surveyors, construction engineers, I believe that to the best of, and based on the 10 quarries that we have surveyed and speaking to them, looking at their costs and the implications of transportation, implications of fuel prices, looking at motion studies of the marine equipment from the stockpile here, which Carlton spoke about, over to the breakwater, I believe that our estimate for this project is reasonably accurate. Yes, there will be natural variations when it is tendered, but to answer that question which had come up, yes, I believe it is accurate. What about disruption in the town from traffic? Well, if I were to ask anyone in the audience how many columns they see there, I'm 90% certain they would say they see 4 columns. The reason why you're seeing 4 columns is because at the base of these columns is what we know, or rather what we are estimating to be 28 trucks per day that will carry boulders to the stockpile area in comparison to the taller bars, which is the current traffic in the grill. Long and short of it is that 28 trucks would account for less than 1% of the existing traffic in the grill. So when we speak about traffic disruption, let us be honest with each other and look at it in the perspective. If there's going to be some disruption at the points where the trucks converge, but these issues are easily dealt with on a day-to-day basis by other projects, by scheduling when the trucks come, to have them come outside of the peak hours of the regular traffic. The usual recommendation is having trucks come between 9 and 11, just outside of the morning peaks. On other projects, what has been done is we've had trucks come to site 6 and 7 in the morning because the truckers like to move when the road is cool and when the air is cool. So these are options which will work out themselves. And these are the options in terms of the times in the day. As you can see, this is the peak traffic in the morning, for between 6 and 8, and again between 4 and 7 in the afternoon. And so we can work in between those two peaks or before the morning peaks. But there are several practical options which can be undertaken. No progress without pain. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Burgess, for answering those questions relative to the concerns. And I'm sure that there are some concerns still residual, and the microphone is there, and you will be called upon to approach the microphone, identify yourself, and then direct the question. We will allow for 2 or so questions, but one person, just one question at a time.